finally got it together. I'm great. I just came back from a mega bike ride out here. It's really beautiful. Me and my son did about, I don't know, maybe 15, 20 miles. Yeah, well, you know, I love biking. It's a great way to stay in shape, and it's really cool. We go easy going. We don't try to kill ourselves. All that kind of stuff is a lot of fun when you just get out. There's no noise. You're just right with nature, and it's really beautiful. Yes, let's talk about rock and roll. Born in New York City, but when I was 17, I went to California to seek my fortune, and that's where I started my career, really, in music. I went to San Francisco, and that's where I met up with Jack Lee and Peter Case, and we started the Nerves. And then from there, we moved down to L.A., and then after the Nerves, I started the Beat, and then, you know, one thing led to another. What got me into music was when I was about 6 or 7, I was living in Vietnam with my family. I've traveled most all my life. My mom's an artist, and she took us all over the world. And I was sitting in a taxi cab, and it was pouring rain, as it will happen out there a lot in Vietnam. And Big Girls Don't Cry came on the radio by Frankie Valli in the Four Seasons, and I went, wow, that is really cool. And then I heard, you know, every once in a while I'd hear these songs on the radio that really knocked me out. And then my dad was a big fan of Hank Williams and Ray Charles. This isn't exactly rock and roll, but those guys really, I think, influenced a lot of rock musicians. And then it was everything on WABC radio when I was, 14 or 15. I used to go to sleep with the radio every night, glued to my ear. And that's why I'm so proud of Hey DJ, which is my latest album. That's kind of like a tribute to those times, just going to sleep with the radio on and hearing all the great stuff from the 60s. Really, I'm a child of the 60s, so I grew up listening to, you know, like everything with Elvis Presley, which is late 50s, Elvis Presley, Little Richard, Chuck Berry, the Beatles, the Stones, the whole British Invasion thing, Beach Boys, the Detroit Sound, the East Coast Sound, the Buckinghams, all those bands. And when you listen to radio, AM radio in those days, it was like just one huge hit single, one great song after another. And I really slipped out on that stuff, and I never thought I could do it myself, but I thought, man, this is really cool. The first instrument I learned how to play was the drums, because I figured, well, you don't really know how to do anything except bang away. So I remember I got my first drum kit. I made myself. It was like, well, I got a Remo snare for Christmas because I told my parents I got to have drums. Got to have drums. So they bought me a snare, which I broke the first day. But so it was like all taped up. And then I used the garbage can with the lid, you know, that you push down with your flip drum. And I forget what I used for the cymbal, something, pots and pans and stuff like that. And I set up my kit out in the garage. I was living in Manhasset, Long Island. And I was like the fifth member of the Beatles for quite a while. And I used to just rock out. And music has always been something that I'm a huge fan of music to this day. And I think that's one of the things, reasons why I still love doing it, because I'm a fan first and foremost. I love listening to music. I love playing music. I love everything about music. I think it's like one of the coolest forms of expression there is. And to be able to do it is really great. Well, some of my favorite bands, I would have to say my all-time favorite band, and that's in that way forever, is the Beatles, just because they influenced me so heavily as a group, as a rock and roll band. I thought, you know, like, this is that's why I wanted to be in a band, because they were a band. They were, like, the ultimate band. And, from there, it's like, I was a big fan of the 60s music, which I already said. new groups, like I was a big fan of early Nirvana, I was a big fan of early U2, I was a big fan of all the, you know, when I started recording myself, you know, the whole new wave 80s things, there were a lot of groups that I really thought were great. I loved Devo, I loved Pear Ubu, I loved Early Police, Joe Jackson, Elvis Costello, the whole, you know, the British sound and the American sound. I mean, there were a lot of, you know, Tom Petty, you know, all that stuff was at, before, like, they started making up names for what it was, all those groups were putting records out, and it was like just rock and roll with us, and it was like pre-New Wave, pre-Power Pop, pre, you know, it was just rock and roll. We didn't tour with them, but we played with them, and we played with them in Cleveland. It was a great night. We played with Devo in Cleveland, and they were that was their hometown. We played with Devo at Pirate's Cove. We played with Pear Ubu. In fact, we hung out with Dave. I forget his last name. We used to just call him Crocus, the lead singer. And he was like, when we came to Cleveland, he was the first person we met. We met him at like at 7 a.m. in the morning. We had gotten in really early, and he said, well, we were supposed to meet him at this park, MacArthur Park. So, like, we're lying on the grass, sleeping, you know, completely crashed out. We've been up all night driving. And I see these two big shoes in front of my face, and I look at it. And it's Crocus from Pear Ubu, and he took us to his favorite Greasy Spoon, and we went to his house, and we hung out with him. He was really, really cool with us. And we played with him. We played with the Rubber City Rebels on the same bill. We played with a lot of people. Those are the guys we did tour with. We did tour with the Ramones. And that was way, way cool. We did, I think, 7 or 8 shows with them. We played with them. We did the very first show in Cleveland, in Cincinnati, at this club called Bogart's. And what happened was, we were in New York City, and we played Max's Kansas City, and that was like the end of the first leg of the Nerves' one and only, you know, national tour. And while we were in New York, we had a break in the dates, and so since I did the booking, it was kind of like my job to get tapes for the band. I went and saw, I got an appointment with Danny Fields, who was the manager of the Ramones, and I want to go on record saying that he was totally cool, because in those days, you know, it's like really hard to talk to anybody in the music business, especially if they were like, you know, on a label or a major label or anything like that. It was really hard to talk to anybody. If you were unknown, which we were, you know, we didn't have an agent, we didn't have a manager, we didn't have a record company. So he was really cool, and he gave me an appointment. I went to his office, which was totally, you know, really, really rock and roll, great office with, you know, posters all over the place on Fifth Avenue, overlooking Fifth Avenue. It was like really, really cool. And I brought him the Nerves 45, and we sat talking, and I said, you know, he said, well, what do you want? And I said, well, we want to do some shows with the Ramones. And he kind of looks at me and goes, yeah, you and everybody else. And so he said, look, he was really nice to me. He said, I tell you what, because I said, well, look, you know, we've been touring all across the country, and I get names and phone numbers of clubs everywhere, you know, maybe I can, you know, maybe we can do something. And he said, well, what I really want is I want to get the Ramones into Cincinnati. If you can get me a gig with the Ramones and you guys in Cincinnati, you can have the 5 shows of their Texas tour. So I picked up the phone, I called this guy who I had been talking to, who wouldn't book just the Nerves, at Bogart's, and I said, hey, I'm sitting here, I'm with Danny Fields, manager of the Ramones, how about the Ramones and the Nerves at Bogart's? And I said, sure. And so that was like the first punk rock show ever in the city of Cincinnati, and I booked it. So he was like, yeah, I was like freaking out. And so then from there, we went to, we did 5 shows with them in Texas, which was really amazing. And I'm talking the original band, with Tommy on drums, and it was incredible. I mean, it was incredible, and it was great because they were, at that point, they were really, really hot. They had been doing a lot of playing, so it was like the quintessential, the epitome of the Ramones sound. Dee Dee was like, you know, they were all in top form. Dee Dee was the guy that I became the most friendly with. He was really, really as a person, really nice guy. And, you know, Johnny and Tommy were, we didn't really have too much to do with him. And Joey was just kind of like, he just was in his own world, so he didn't really talk to too many people. I was always amazed, though, because he was, like, standing there with, like, clothes are all ripped up, and it's just, like, swarms of girls around him, like, trying to do everything they could to take care of him. But he was a guy that you could become friends with, and we hung out with him, and he was really nice. And he did a lot of songwriting with the Ramones, so he really dug our songs, and we would talk about songwriting and stuff. And he was just, like, so cool. And he was the one that I was the most upset when I, you know, when he passed away. But because I was closest to him, I mean, it's not like, you know, when Joey died, it was like, oh my God, you know, these guys are my age, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, fuck, what's going on? But he was very ill for a long, long time. He was even kind of ill then. He was always, you know, he was always battling. You know, he just had a lot of problems. Yeah, and it's a drag. And if you see that documentary, End of the Century, it's like, I mean, I knew them and it was great touring with them, but that's a sad movie. It's really was not, you know, what I think a lot of people thought it would be. Oh, I played CBGBs a ton of times. CBGBs, like, when I started playing there, Hilly Crystal was a guy that either people said he was, like, the meanest bastard in the world or he's the nicest guy in the world. And to me, he was always really nice. He liked my band, liked my music, and he would always give us shows there. He never charged us for drinks. He always paid us. And we always had a great time playing there. You know, in those days, there was so much stuff going on. I can't remember whether the beer was any good or not. We were flying. We were doing everything. So it didn't, you know, I can't remember the beer. I'm sure, you know, we drank. I didn't drink beer when I was at that point. I was drinking vodka tonics nonstop. What inspires me now or then? Okay, what inspires me besides music, because music really still is like one of the main things in my life, is women. You know, they're very inspiring. Love is very inspiring. And then traveling, because I get to see so many like amazing things when I travel, you know. Just, you know, like people, cultures, and just, you know, countrysides, and you know, it's like, I tour all over Europe, and I mean, it's great. I mean, nature is inspiring. I know that sounds corny, but, you know, it really is. Like, today we were riding our bikes out in the middle of nowhere, and it's, like, really beautiful, and you look at it, and you go, wow, this is cool. But what still rocks my world is music. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, I guess. I mean, I don't do too much drugs anymore, but I love drinking wine. I love drinking red wine, and that's what I've been living, spent the last 7 years living in Spain, and the wine there is just incredible. And, you know, the ladies are always fun to look at and be around. When they're acting nice. When they're not nice, it's hell on wheels. Let's see. We played with The Police, which was one of the greatest shows I ever did, which was in Paris, of the Ramones, of course. We played with Joe Jackson. We did a New Year's show with him in L.A. once. That was really cool. We played with The Jam, which was really cool. We played with Southside Johnny in Brooklyn. That was great. We did a bunch of shows with Eddie Money, which is a different kind of music than what I do, but he was really nice to us, and he really helped us a lot. And I learned a lot about show business from him, because he really knew a lot about just, you know, show biz. And so we did some cool shows with him. We played with Huey Lewis. That was cool. Mm-hmm. We really dig what we do, and we're real professional, and we don't make trouble. So bands usually like working with us, because, you know, we just do our job, and we're, you know, we're always on time, and, you know, we're real pro about what we do, and we don't have any big attitude. And actually, we just did, the last time we played South by Southwest, which is great. I mean, it's just, incredible. I mean, it's like 1,500 bands, 4 days, all kinds of music. You can really hear a lot of great stuff. And then a lot of people come and play in unofficial showcases. So it's just like music everywhere. And we got invited to play this barbecue with these, this put together, the band that invited us is called Beat Deep Beat. They're from Atlanta. And that's, we're going to actually go play with some of those guys. We're playing with Gentleman Jesse in Atlanta August 27th. And the whole show came together from this guy, this guy Warren, who plays in Beat Deep Beat. They invited us to play this barbecue. And it was all these young bands. And I felt like, you know, I don't know why they invited us to play, because, like, you know, these guys, it's like a whole different trip. But everybody knew my music, and we played with, like, Beat Beat Beat, who were great. We played with this band. Have you ever heard this band called Slushy Boys, I think it is? Incredible. They're, like, 17 years old. They have to go with, like, a chaperone to get into the clubs that they play. Really, really good. And just, I don't know, it's like you see... For a while, like towards the end of the 90s, I was like, oh man, music really sucks now. There's nothing happening. There's just rap music. Grunge had like completely obliterated everything. It's like getting so formula that it was like everything sounded the same. Like American radio was horrible. And I can say, like, you know, and everybody, you know, they've been telling me rock and roll's dead for 30 years now. And I was finally starting to believe them. Yeah, rock is dead. You know, this all sucks. It's all bullshit.
Yeah.
And with the internet, and then with MySpace, I started to see that there was all these, like, you know, great new young bands. They weren't signed to labels, but every time I get a MySpace request, I go to the page and I listen to it, because fortunately, all I do is play music. That's how I make my living. So, and I spend a fair amount of time on the internet, you know, either with my website or answering fan mail or you know, just, you know, doing my MySpace stuff. And so I go to all these pages, and a lot of the times, I'm like listening to music, and I go, wow, this shit is good. It's like, you know, it's like there's a whole new wave, I guess, of bands and musicians coming out that are doing rock and roll. Some of it's influenced by new wave, some of it's power pop, some of it's punk, but it's like all blended together now. It's like, not like when I started out, punk was punk. Punk bands hated power pop bands. Power pop bands didn't like punk bands. You wouldn't see a punker at a power pop show. Now it's all across the board. You know, you can see everybody at a show, and it's great. And so I think it's really, you know, rock and roll will never die. Anytime they say it's going to die, it's just a bunch of crap. You know, they've been saying it for 30 years, and it's not going to die. As long as there's a kid that plugs in a guitar into an amp and cranks it up, rock and roll's going to be fine. Well, one of the greatest shows the Nerves ever did was in Toronto at this place called the Crash and Burn, which was part of the college there, or the University of Toronto, or whatever it is. That was amazing. We played the Austin Armadillo, which was incredible. It's no longer there. That was amazing. We played the